It's Wednesday, March 4th, and this is our Blog Fest with Eric Zorn and Mary Schmich of the Chicago Tribune. I'm John Williams from WGN Radio, and we've got a few things to talk to them about. Let's talk a little bit about Blago's book, Should He Write It? Would You Read It? Let's talk a little bit, guys, about Roland Burris. Is it time to move on? Where do you think the Dow will close at the end of the year? The president says it's a political barometer, too, so how optimistic are we over the next several months? And do you find yourself buying more lottery tickets? Mary, we'll start with you. Should the governor write a book?
Of course he should, and I'll read it, and I won't believe much of anything in it. But I'll read it. I want Eric Zorn to ghostwrite this book, however. I think the governor underestimates how difficult it is to write a book.
First of all, I will believe a lot of what he says in this book. I think that
really?
He's going. Yeah, I'm not going to believe everything that he says in it, but I am looking forward to this book, and I think that he should write it because I think he is a smart man, especially in the ways of politics. I mean, this is a guy. Remember, he's a working class Chicago kid who, 4 or 5 years ago, was considered to be a possible contender for the presidency of the United States. I mean, he's a guy who had really worked all the angles. Well, he had played the game the way it's supposed to be played. He misplayed it badly in the last few years, no question about that. But he has really lived through some interesting times and some interesting experiences. Now, he's got this self-righteous streak and this lack of self-awareness and lack of humility that's going to make parts of the
book. A delusional streak.
Yeah, a completely excruciating to read. But he is also... he's not a dumb person. I mean, he did a lot of dumb things, but he's not a dumb person. I'm looking forward to what he has to say.
But because you think it'll be interesting to see what it's like in the mind of a madman, or you think he's got actual political insight into
politics? No, I think he has experience and insight. I think he does know a lot about how the game is played. I think that he is in denial about a lot of the things that he did. I think he's delusional about some things in his own career, but I do think that his own take on his story is going to be fascinating.
Well,
it's not the whole story. I think it's going to be a really interesting part of the story. I'm looking forward to it.
But even if you've got a good story, it's hard to write it well. And my question is whether he can write a book that's compelling to read. The facts aside, will it be a good tale? I think he probably needs somebody to help him write it.
Yeah, I think he does. And he probably will. And I think apparently he's been out with his legal pad sitting down, you know, writing furiously for the last couple of days. And I think at some point he's going to sit down and realize that writing a book. I only have one experience in writing a book, which was many years ago. And it was a lot harder than I thought it was going to be. I thought, gee, you know, because I knew what I was writing about very well. There's a lot of
information. Well, because it begins as journaling, right? I mean, if you're writing about yourself, it's just your memories. It's like writing a journal, but then you realize, oh no, I actually need a structure. I need a narrative.
I did kind of come around like you did, though, Eric. I thought, oh, this is all preposterous. It reminds me of OJ if I did it, and I just don't want you to profit any more on your crimes and your ugliness. Deal. But then I thought, you know what? If this guy does tell truths and he's angry and is motivated to really do so, then it might be kind of fascinating, if you could tell which was true and which was not, to see what he has to say. It might be a revelatory book that way, even valuable.
I'm willing to believe that he will tell a version of the truth that is convenient to him, but I have trouble believing that it would be the truth as other people would recognize it.
I'm still wondering why he's not going with a major publishing house and getting a major editor to work with him, because... there was something about there were conditions that were put on him. It was a very strange story about that. But if he gets a good editor who pushes him to go beyond his sort of trite summaries about, you know, I mean, he's got a weakness for saying, you know, I'm fighting for people. But, you know, there's got to be a fascinating behind-the-scenes story.
Look
about
what happened to the McGreevy, the New Jersey governor who came out with quite the – he had a good story to tell. Remember
Did
him?
He, though? I mean,
he appointed as the head of what was their equivalent of Homeland Security his gay lover that he met in Israel. And he brought this guy over, and he was a complete disaster, and it ruined his career and his second marriage. So that's a good story.
But it's an anecdote.
That book sold badly, you know, and he was very popular on the talk show circuit the way our governor was for a while.
Well, no one outside Illinois will read this book about Rob Blagojevich. He's a very minor character to the rest of the country.
Oh, I disagree about that, too. He's got connections to Rahm Emanuel. He's got connections to Obama. I mean,
but people don't want to read the book. They will read the magazine excerpt of the book. They're not going to pay hardback.
Is it time to move on Roland Burris? I mean, we've pretty well decided how we all feel about it. Everybody in the state has. Is it time for the state to just write out this term.
Yes.
Well, if we use our weather vane governor, Pat Quinn, yes, it's time. You know, I was busting him earlier this week on my online. I was comparing what he was saying last Friday on WGN, where he's saying, we must pass this bill and have a special election. If Roland Burris won't quit, we have to vote him out. He said that on Friday on this on WGN. And then on Monday, he goes, well, maybe it's time to move on.
You know, but does that mean that he's wrong to have changed his mind?
Well, I think that it probably is time to move on. But I think you have to have a little bit more awareness of what's going on in order to come out, you know, emphatically one way and emphatically the other in the course of 3 days. I mean, that's
why do you guys think he flip flopped on that?
Because he realized that moving on was the correct thing to do.
And he was getting a lot.
There was also there was pressure from him, I think. I mean, I think the more we see Roland Burris with a lot of support, especially in the African-American community, you know, he's just realized this is kind of politically no win for him to keep what feels like badgering, what many people would perceive as badgering.
Well, I think Mary's right about talking about it has become a racial issue, that the African-American pastors gathering around Roland Burris has made it much more of a politically sensitive issue. And I think Quinn realizes, and I think he's right, which is that we got a lot bigger problems than whether we have a lightweight senator or a senator without a lot of
that really ticks people off. You know, I took a lot of calls about this, and people were upset that race card is what sealed the deal to get him the job. And then the second time around, you think he may be a snake about this, but the race card is yet what's going to keep the job. And people are upset about that, and I suspect, like you two, that the prudent thing to do is to let them be upset and then vote them out of office if they're still unhappy about it in 12, 15, 18 months, whatever it's going to be.
Yeah, I mean, the truth is that whoever gets elected, if Burris were to step aside and we were to appoint another Democrat, the person would probably vote the same way that Burris is going to vote.
Yeah.
So it's not like it's not like someone who is the junior senator in Washington is going to have a great deal of impact in the short amount of time that Burris is going to be there either way. I mean, he could go there and do almost nothing but cast a few votes. It's not going to make a big difference.
Well, exactly. And we do have other business to do.
Big problems.
So even though you don't want to reward Roland Burris or people who have maybe supported him, you don't want to reward them for their tactics or their persistence. Mm-hmm. Well, it is time to move on.
The president said this week that the Dow Jones Industrial Average, the market, is kind of a political indicator, too. He wasn't discounting the fundamentals, but it's an interesting point because the worse his plan goes in the selling, the lower the market goes. And you think that if Obama could have some sort of verbal bounce, that the market might bounce too. So I've been asking people where you think the market's going to finish at the end of the year, financially, but also politically. Give me a 1,000-point range. We're under 7,000 in this, the first full week of March. Where do you think it's going to finish December 31st? In a 1,000-point range.
Between 11 and 12.
You are kidding.
I'm optimistic.
Oh, God. Give him a hug for me.
Is there a prize for winning?
Yeah.
Is there punishment for getting it wrong?
No, there's not. But the prize is my 401k's got a little more lifeblood into it. Why would you say? Everybody's an economist now. Isn't that funny?
Oh, yeah.
It's sort of like we were all geopolitical experts and generals when we went into war. And then everybody said, well, I think that we need to do this with the troops and the surge. And we don't know anything about that. Now we're all economists. So why in the world do you think it's going to close above 11?
Well, I think that there is some truth to what Obama says, is that what the Dow reflects is confidence. I mean, it is definitely rooted in reality. I mean, some of what he said is not quite right, because we do have this banking crisis. We do have this capitalization problem of these banks. And that's not a whole lot
of people out of work.
You can't just wish that system away. But there is a lot of it that's reflected in confidence, whether people believe that what their investments are going to pay off. I mean, 11 to 12 is pretty high, but I do think it's going to be over 10.
Well, the market historically precedes the economy, so that the market will get better before the job situation does. That could happen, I guess, in theory.
I mean, it's early March, right? I mean, there's a long time to go. And
Explain it no more. 11 plus, right?
I mean, it may go below 6. I mean, I don't know, but I do think it's going to come back. I mean, it almost has to come back.
Economist Mary?
I'm not going to play, John, because I don't have a clue.
Well, now that's not fair. Come on. What fun is that?
Okay. 8,700.
8,700. Between 8 and 9, closer to 9. If we're trading around. I'll tell you what. If we were close to 9, 9 to me is the new 14. I remember it lingered around around 9 after the election. And you said, okay, after the inauguration, we had two or three up days above 9,000. I thought, okay, if you just stay there, I can probably see me surviving this. Now we're at 6-something. So if it finished above 9, I'd be happy. So optimistically, I'll say it's going to finish between 9 and 10, but closer to 9.